my theme for this month is God has got you penciled in for more. God has got you penciled in for more. And he showed me that if you were serious about being penciled in for more, then you have got to give him total control.
All right.
To give him total control. Look at two people and say, total control. See, that's an okay today, right here, right now. You can't move because you haven't given him total control. You cannot advance on anything that you are doing because you have not given him total control.
All right, now.
You can't defeat your enemies or your set of circumstances because you still in there scratching and clawing, and the Lord is saying, all you have to do is just give me total control. I'm gonna speak it anyway. Somebody, you are afraid all the time. You worried about what could happen, or you worried about what might happen, or you worried that what you read in the mail is going to happen, or what somebody said on the end of the phone is about to take place. Why? Because you have not given him total control. And one of the biggest flaws, one of the biggest setbacks that we have, or reasons why folk will not give him total control, because in many cases, when we look at ourselves and when we examine ourselves and when we think about all the things that we are doing or all the things that we have done, many of us look at ourselves and don't see how we can have a God on our side. But I stopped by to tell you this morning for just a few minutes that God does his best blessing when you're at your lowest level. I stopped by to tell you that God does his greatest miracles when you can't see a thing. I'm trying to bless somebody right now. God, when you think you don't have a seat at the table, that's when he'll pull up your chair. When you think you're not worthy to be rescued, that's when he'll throw you a show love lifeline. When you think that you're the person or the last one on the totem pole, that's when he'll come to you and prove beyond a shadow of doubt, as the scriptures say, that the last shall be first. And if somebody knows what I'm talking about, you ought to give God the praise. I don't need you to praise him based on what I'm saying. I need you to praise him right now because you know what I'm saying is true. In order for him to pencil you in for more, you have got to give him total control. Look at this word that we have on this morning is a familiar text. It is a text, as I said last week, that has been preached by me and has at one time it has been preached by me. But I dare you to come with me for just a few moments as I give you this text or preach you this text from a perspective that you have never heard it before, to the glory of God. Amen? Amen. This word is here in the 8th chapter in just verses 1 through 11. It's totally set up in the 7th chapter. And I need you to read the 7th chapter this week in your study time, because if you don't understand the 7th chapter, you have no shot at grasping what it means to give him total control in the 8th chapter, so you can get your blessing and get penciled in for the more that God has set aside for you. Because it's in the 7th chapter that there is division over who Jesus is. Okay, I teach for just a moment. See, what most folk don't understand or don't realize, and I didn't learn it until I went to school for, that's why I challenge everybody to get educated or spend time in the Word, is that when Jesus died, I'm jumping ahead just a little bit here right now. If people didn't jump on board right away and start praising God and start following Jesus right away, it wasn't until hundreds of years after his death, when people began to really read the scripture, that they understood who he really was. So it should come as no surprise in the 7th chapter that they were arguing there was division over who he is. They were arguing because of where he was and he came from. They were arguing because of the manner in which he spoke in. They were arguing because of the authority that he had. They were arguing with him about his claim of being the Son of Man and the Messiah and the Savior of the world. And so there was division over who it is that Jesus is. And then just before the 8th chapter, Jesus had to turn around and deal with the fact that the religious leaders of the church had made it abundantly clear that they were going to kill him. They made it abundantly clear that they were going to assassinate him. They let him know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the first time we give chance to take you out, we're going to take you out. The first time we get a chance to kill you, we're going to kill you. But in spite of all of that and through all of that, here is Jesus beginning in the 8th chapter, ready to do what it is that his Father would have him doing. And before I go there, I just got to say this because it's on my heart this morning. Don't you ever let no devil in hell tell you that they gonna do something to you and then keep you from doing what it is that Jesus has told you to do. Don't you ever let no boss on the job, or don't you ever let no baby's daddy, or don't you ever let no one that can't see that God's handprint is on your life turn around and tell you that because of where you came from, or because of what degree you don't have, or because of the way you look, or because of the way you walk, or because of the way you talk, or because of the way you praise, or because of the way you sing, or because of the way you act. When the Spirit of the living God makes your soul happy, don't you let nobody stop you from doing what it is that God has assigned to you and has assigned for you. I stop by to tell you, that's when you really take your coat off. That's when you really throw your hat back. That's when you really lift your holy hand. That's when you really let everybody know. Talk about me all that you will. Say what you will about me. But I know something that you must not know. That my Savior's name is Jesus. And as long as I got Jesus on my side, you can talk about me all you want. All you're doing is giving me free publicity. You're announcing to the whole world that I'm a difference maker. Look at three people and say, I'm a difference maker. I'm a difference maker. Here we are, beginning with verse chapter number 8 and verses 1 through 3. I need you to read those for me, if you would, Jessica, start for me right there.
But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives.
Oh, I got to stop you right there. You need to have a private place for you and God. Oh, see, one of the main reasons why you can't get penciled in for anything is because you never make the time to have an intimate place with God. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. That was his private place. That was a place he always went to and retreated to whenever he wanted to be alone with his Father. That was a place he went to when he was scared. That was a place he went to when he needed to be refreshed. That was a place that he went to when he needed his spirit to be renewed. And I want to tell somebody today that if you want to know what God has got you penciled in for, you need to have you a Mount of Olives. Your Mount of Olives might be in your bathroom. Your Mount of Olives might be in your car. Your Mount of Olives might be in your cubicle at work. But you need to make sure that you have a private place for you and God where you can talk to God and you can tell God all about your problem and all about your sorrow. Or I'm just praising by myself. I thank God for the fact that he lets me know that I live and breathe because of the time I spend with him. I thank God that he let me know that I get my prayers answered and I get my breakthroughs, not because of the sermons I hear or not because of the high fives I give, but I get them through because of the time I spend with my Father. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me. I get my breakthroughs when the world can't see it, and I take it to God and say, Father, not my will, but let thy will be done. And I don't have nobody else around. You see, it's something about talking to God when ain't nobody else around. It's something about talking to God when there's tears running down your eyes, when you can crawl across the floor or lay down on your back or talk to him about all the things about you and let him know this stuff is real and I can't make it without you on my side. And I gotta talk to you for myself right now. And I can't talk to you around nobody else. I can't talk to you with the choir looking. I can't talk to you with the church looking. I can't talk to you in front of my co-workers or my friends. I got to be alone with you so I can petition you and let you know where I'm really at. Is there anybody here that knows that God answers prayer when you give him time of intimacy? Go to the Mount of Olives after they break his life, after they talked about him, after they ridiculed him, after they tried to demoralize him. Jesus retreats, and if Jesus could retreat to talk to his Father, why can't you and I? If Jesus could retreat to talk to his Father to get a breakthrough, we need to follow the pattern that he has set and go to God and talk to him about our every need. Amen? Amen. Come on.
He appeared again in the temple courts. where all the people gathered around him. And he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery."
That word again is a very important word because it suggests that something similar has taken place here before. You see, Jesus, he's in a sitting in a seat of adversity because as I told you previously, he knows that there's a contract on him and he knows that they want to kill him. But still, here he is going back to the place and giving honor to his father and following through with the assignment that he has been given by his father. And some of us can't get penciled in because you want your blessing, but you don't want to fight for the breakthrough to get your blessing. Oh, here's Jesus. He said, I'm going to go back and I'm going to teach this word. I'm going to go back and I'm going to sit down before these people. I'm going to go back and I'm going to pour myself out in spite of my current set of circumstances. I'm going to make sure that if today is the day that my Father's going to get the glory out of everything that comes out of my mouth, I'm going to make sure that in spite of what it is that you issue, that I don't fear you because I stand for the Lord. And as long as my day has got my back, everything is going to be all right. Everything is going to be all right. But here he is in verse number 3. It says the teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman that was caught in adultery. And there are 36 words between verses 3 and 4. And the word adultery appears in there 2 times. The word caught appears in there at least twice. The word caught means that she was caught. She was. It was no doubt about it. She was caught. It is no. No doubt that she was caught. This thing that they're accusing her of, she actually has done exactly what that thing is. And when you think about that woman, and I talked about her before, when you think about the fact that she was drugged in to the church, half naked in the church, and thrown before the people in the church, and then ridiculed and being pointed and being accused in front of the church, that means she had to be at her lowest point. I'm trying to go somewhere with this one, because it's one thing to give him total control when everything is going okay. It's another thing to give him total control when the whole world is looking at you and they know that you've done something wrong. And that's the part I'm trying to get to this morning, is that when we think about total control, we think about it oftentimes from a positive aspect. But I dare you right now, in your gutter situation, because somebody's got a gutter situation going on right now, somebody's got a heavy load going on right now, to think about the fact that God is the same, whether you're up here or whether you're down there, or I think I just said something, he's the same. His mercy does not change. His grace does not change. His efficiency does not change. His will to serve, his will to please, his will to bless you, it does not change. Yes, here we have this woman who is caught in adultery. And then in verse 5 says that they talked to Jesus and they told him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in adultery, and the law of Moses commands us to stone such a woman. And now what do you have to say?" You know, there's nothing worse than lying church folk. Well, I wish I had somebody with me right now. There's nothing worse than folk up in the house of God that won't tell the truth about what's really going on. There's nothing worse than a liar. It's one thing to be a liar in the street. It's one thing to be a liar on your job. It's another thing to be a liar in your crib. Well, I'll just go there by myself. But it's terrible when you are a liar and you claim it to be a gospel care. It's terrible when you are a liar and you claim it that you love the Lord, that you will put your mouth on something or somebody or say something about something or somebody, and you don't even have all the facts, or you don't even know the person, or you don't even know what it is that's going on. It's worse than daggone shame. I said the daggone shame. I could have went worse when the people that claim to be servants of God would turn around and use their authority in the wrong way. Or where am I going? Where am I going? If you look at verse 5, they said that the law calls for the woman to be stoned. That's what they told Jesus. But what they didn't do was they didn't get the whole truth. You see, the law didn't just call for the woman to be stoned. The law called for whoever was caught in adultery to be stoned. So that means if they had brought the sister, the brother should have been there too. That means if they had brought the sister, the brother should have been right there. But here they were, twisting the word of God. Why? Because because they wanted to get to Jesus. They wanted to get to him any way that they could. And I'm trying to bless somebody up in here this morning. If you look at verse 5 and then look at verse number 6, it says they did this in order to trap Jesus. And I'm trying to tell somebody today that Satan will do whatever he has to do to try to trap you. Oh, that's why it's important that the church is filled with Holy Ghost filled people, because he'll come to the place that you least expect. He'll come to the territory that you don't think he'll invade. He'll go to people that you think stand for one thing in order to get to you, in order to get after you, in order to stop you from doing what it is that God would have you to do. Oh, look at the word. They went after Jesus, and so they twisted this thing. They manipulated this thing. And if the world would do that to Jesus, what do you think Satan would try to do to you? And that's why, as a believer, you got to stay praying. That's why, as a believer, you got to stay fasting. That's why, as a believer, every now and then, you just got to get up on your feet, like right now, in spite of what everybody else is doing. And you just got to thank God. And you just got to praise God. And you got to praise him for protection. Oh, somebody don't feel me yet. You'd be surprised how close the enemy is to you. You'd be surprised how close the devil is to you. You'd be surprised at who he's working on or working through. They're trying to get at you. They're trying to get to you. But I dare you, in times like that, to just call upon the name of Jesus and say, Jesus, I need you to protect me. Jesus, I need you to provide for me. I can't figure all these folk out, but I know one thing. If thou be for me, who can be against me? Is there somebody that wants to just give him a praise for protection up in the house right now? No matter how much they lie, no matter what they said, no matter what they did, they're trying to keep you down. You're about to walk up out of that thing and walk into your new miracle and walk into your new blessing. Say yes! They were trying to trap him. They were trying to trap him. They were trying to trick him. They were trying to trap him. Oh, some of you are so naive. Every time something goes wrong, you start saying, God, why did you let that happen to me? Every time something doesn't go your way, the first thing that comes out your mouth is, oh, God, why? You need to understand. You need to put the blame where it really belongs. Satan is after you because of the Jesus that's up in you. Satan is after you because he sees the future that God has got you penciled in for. Satan is after you because he knows that prosperity is just up the street. Satan is after you because he sees that your children are going to be great vessels for the Lord. Satan is after you because he sees that your son and daughter is about to become a brave warrior or an evangelist or a prophet. Satan is after you because he knows that you're not going to stay broke for long, so he wants to break you before you can get to your material blessing. Satan is after you because of a prayer that are in you and the things that God has put inside of you. And if you are tired of being tricked, and you are tired of being trapped, and you are tired of falling for those spells, I tell you to tell God, I've got a But I need you to read the bottom part of verse number 6. Read 6b for me, Jessica, and then Reverend Jeff.
They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him.
That's the A part, the B part.
But Jesus began and started to write on the ground with his finger.
All right, you know the devil can try and do anything to you, but you don't have to participate in his stupidity. Oh, I think I can say something. He can try and do whatever he wants to do to you, but you don't have to participate in what it is that he is trying to do to you. Look at the word right here. When they started acting crazy with Jesus, Jesus didn't get all up. Jesus didn't get all rough. Jesus didn't go ghetto. He just bent down and started writing in the dirt. Now, he chilled out like he did because he understood whose he is. You see, you might come against me, but that don't mean you got me. You might be talking smack to me, but that don't mean your smack talk is going to do something to me against me. You might have your tongue and your mind made up about how it is this the thing going to go, but I stop by to tell you that my daddy has got the final say so on everything. And so when it gets crazy, I can still be cool. When it gets crazy, I can still get my praise on. When it gets crazy, I can still have my joy. When it gets crazy, I can still tell somebody God is good. When it gets crazy, I can still testify. When it gets crazy, I can still raise my hand. When it gets crazy, I can still stomp my feet. When it gets crazy, I can still get my dance on. When it gets crazy, I can still kick back.
Keep in mind what they had just done. They caught the woman in
sin adultery. Look at somebody and say, that means she was guilty. They caught her in adultery. And when he straightened up, he addressed her. And he said, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. Why can't I bless somebody right now? I need you to understand what he did. This way is complicated, Reverend Rita. He upheld the law of God, but he made sure that they understood that they were applying it the wrong way. Can I teach this right now? He said, let any one of you who is without sin cast the first stone. In other words, he was saying, Tanisha and Isaac and Jerron, the fact that the word says that when someone commits adultery, that stoning is an option. And I got something I want you to do. If you got stoning on the agenda today, then go ahead and get your rocks. If stoning is in your heart today, go ahead and get your rocks. Stay with me. If stoning is what it is that you can't get to do today, then I need you to get your rock. But I just got one stipulation. I just got one qualification. I just got one situation about the application of a proposition that's about to take place over this circumstance. I want any one of you that has never sinned, I want the one that threw a rock to be somebody. Drop it. Drop it. Drop it. Drop it. How you gonna talk about me? Drop it. How you gonna badmouth somebody? Drop it. Stone. Then verse 8 says he stooped down and he wrote in the ground again. You see, when you know who your father is, you ain't scared. Remember, I told you they wanted him. But here's where we are. And I said it again, and this is the third time, and I'm almost done. Verse 9 through 11. Mike, can I have you to read that for me, Reverend Jefferson?
At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman still standing there.
I look at your name and say, remember.
Straightened up and asked her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?
Have mercy. Look at somebody and say, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Come on.
No one, sir, she said. Then neither do I condemn you, Jesus declared. Go now and lead your life of sin.
This woman is guilty. This woman has done exactly what they said. But in the midst of everything that has happened to this woman, not one time does this woman try to wrestle the control of the situation out of the hands of Jesus. There's somebody over there that's better. You in something, you a part of something, and something is going down. And the mistake that you keep making is when folk come at you in an accusatory tone, or when they attack you, instead of you giving him total control, you try to wrestle that thing out of his hand and try to handle that thing yourself. Look at this word. This woman doesn't do one thing. Can I bless somebody? This woman, she gets caught in adultery. She must have had a reputation. She only speaks three words in the whole text. She doesn't say a thing. And there are so many times that we are surrounded by trouble, surrounded by situation, and we are penciled in for a blessing. See, the stuff that you're looking at that you think is bad or harmful is really God trying to do a miracle in your life. You see the miracle of this text, get this, Elder Mabel, is not the fact that he rescued her from stoning, but the miracle of this text is that he gave her a future. In the midst of all she was doing, Jesus gave her a future, and not one time did she have to do anything, and she was guilty. What does that tell you this morning? That would tell you that if God could do it for her, then he can do the same thing for you. God will let you go into a courtroom. God will have somebody do all kind of matter of evil. God will let them think they've gotten away with it. And at just the right time, if you don't interfere and you give him total control of the situation, God will do some awesome things for you and in your life and through you right now. Well, nobody over here understand. Let me try it right here. If God be for you, who can be against you? You might be guilty of the situation, but if he's on your side, he will intercede for you and he will plead your case. Is there somebody over here that had to do something for you that you never did deserve? Is there somebody in the back that had to step up and step in for you, even when you had nothing? total control. Look at the word. This is her life they're talking about. This is her story that they're telling. But she gives him total control. She lets him do what it is that it is, and she knows that she came to know why she was there, that he's able to do, and that's what it is that you need to do today. So I said I was going to be through quick, and so I'm going to do that. So the question ought to be right now is, if God has got me penciled in for more, then how is it that I ought to give him total control? And before I go there with my two or maybe three quick points, I need you to just take a 7-second praise break right now and give him the glory. Get this, Vince, get this, Vince, get this, everybody from the front to the back. Make sure that you wait around to get penciled in. Oh, I think I just said something. Well, I'm right here in verse number 9. Can I read this verse to you? Reverend Jefferson, will you read verse number 9 for me again? Listen to this now.
At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time. The older ones first.
Right there, stop right there. Who went away? All those who heard, they began to leave. They left when? One at a time. Look at the word. The older one first. And then what does it say?
Until only Jesus was left, with the woman still standing there.
Yo, y'all just missed that. If you hadn't, then you'd be on your feet right now. I need you to look at this word and think about this word right now. When they dropped their rocks, she could have left running. When they dropped their rocks, she could have fled the scene. When they dropped their rock, she could have tried to blend in with the rest of the crew. But when they all had left, look at the word, Jesus was still there, bent down. Come on and read verse number 10. What does it say? He was left there all over who?
Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?"
Lord have mercy. Look at that again, verse 9. Only until Jesus was left with the woman standing. Oh, y'all still just missed it. Everybody had tried to kill this woman. And when she was awarded her get out of jail free card, instead of her leaving the scene, she stayed there in the presence of Jesus and didn't go nowhere at that particular moment of time. Well, I'm gonna get there anyhow. Somebody here today needs to understand that everything that has happened to you did happen to you. But when that situation is over, the best place for you to be in order to get penciled in is to still be standing there waiting for Jesus. Oh, I'm trying to bless somebody up in the house right now. This woman didn't run. She stayed right there. The woman caught in adultery. The woman with a bad reputation. The woman with no clothes on her back. The woman that had been accused. The woman that was facing death didn't run and flee, but she stood right there in the presence of Jesus, and she waited for Jesus. And I'm trying to tell somebody today that if you are going through something right now, or there's something happening in your life right now, or you want to get penciled in for your blessing, I tell you, just stand right there and just wait on Jesus. Jesus, if you stay down here, just you remember, I'm going to wait. If you don't answer my prayer until you get ready, I'm going to stand here and I'm going to wait. If everybody else leaves, I'm going to stand here and I'm going to wait. If all others forsake you, I'm going to stand right here and wait. I ain't going nowhere. Look at somebody and tell them, I ain't going nowhere. Oh, I'm looking at this situation. Can I testify for the woman? I can hear the testifier saying, everybody wanted to do me in, only one person. getting penciled in for what God has for you, and you want to give him total control, then you got to stop looking for the wrong thing. Closely at the word, when Jesus tells this woman that she can go, this woman didn't say, Jesus, if I go, then I'm going to be waiting for me around the corner. When he told this woman she could go, she didn't wonder whether or not it was okay to go. You see, when I say stop looking for the wrong thing, let me tell you what I mean. Can I go there? There are too many times when God tells us how to get penciled in for our blessing, but we want insurance. If you promise it'll be all right, then I'll go. If you let me know everything's going to work out, then I'll go. If you show me a sign ahead of time, then I'll go. If you give me the keys to the thing before I get to the thing, then I'll go. If you show me what my package is going to be, and then I'll go. But I stop by to tell you as I prepare to take my seat. And we don't have a God of insurance, but we serve a God of assurance. Oh, I wish I had some folks with me all over the church right now. I wish I had some believers with me. You see, insurance, you have to select a plan. Insurance, you gotta pick up coverage. Insurance, you gotta show some qualifications. Insurance, you gotta pay a price, pay a monthly fee. But assurance lets you know that it's already been paid for. Assurance, I wish I had some folks with me up in the house right now. Assurance is knowing that he's God and he's God all by himself. Assurance is what he said to Moses when he told Moses, I want you to go to Pharaoh. And when he asks you who I am or who sent you, you just tell him, I am sent you. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me right now. Assurance is what it was that he did with David when, in spite of all that David did, he told David, you a man after my own heart. Assurance is what he did with Zacchaeus when he told him, it's okay for you to come down out of that tree. Assurance is what he did for Peter when he told him, and he called him in a lie, when Peter said, if even if all forsake you, I never will. But he came back to Peter and he made that thing right. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me, so I just praise him by myself. Assurance is knowing that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Assurance is trusting the Lord with all thy heart and lean not upon your own understanding. Assurance is knowing that you are more than a conqueror. Assurance is trusting in the word of God. But Jesus said, I'll be with you always, even to the very
praise right now.
God has got you penciled in for more. If you give him total control. That's what's missing in somebody's life here today. You have not given him total control. You've given him the bits and pieces that you want him to have. But when you give him total control, even on those times when you don't deserve mercy, just like this woman did, he will step in for you, he will step in with you, and he will do it if you just give him total control.